Tonight, we celebrate 25 years of the world over. The greatest moments, the most important interviews and personalities, and a special announcement at the end. Gather the whole family for a very special celebration. The World Over 25th Anniversary Special begins right now.
Raymond Arroyo.
A warm welcome to all of you joining us in the United States and the world over. A quarter of a century. It doesn't seem possible. The World Over is the longest running program still in production at EWTN, and all of that is due to your support and your tuning in week after week. So happy anniversary. 25 years ago, Mother Angelica asked me to start a news division, and this show was our first creation. It was to be a weekly news magazine that encompassed the church, the arts, politics, science, and the pressing issues of the day. Mother gave me a very simple charge: tell the truth. Actually, she said, and I quote, "It's your obligation to speak the truth, and everyone can either take it or leave it, but truth must be in us. We live in such poverty of the truth today." In addition to that, she wanted me to inspire and uplift the audience along the way. She didn't want the show to be a sterile barrage of miseries.
Now we have Raymond Arroyo. I did that pretty good.
Boy, right, real
put
Hispanic.
That R right where it should be. And he's the new news director. Welcome to our family, Raymond.
Thank you for having me.
You know, I've always wanted a news program. Because I'm going to do a takeoff on the news. Today, there was a tornado. Destroyed the entire city, that little village, totally gone, wiped out. George, what's the news? What's the weather? He goes from the news to the weather, like, oh well. And you know, I've always resented that. Nobody feels compassion from the news. We feel anger. We feel resentment. We feel everything but something good.
Over the past quarter century, we've tried to program a diverse show that is informative, challenging, and inspiring. There's always a mix of hard-hitting news revealing the truth behind the headlines, as well as personal interviews with iconic artists, religious leaders, sportsmen, politicians, and musicians, showing a side of them rarely seen anywhere else in the media. Over the next hour, we'll revisit some of our favorite interviews, personalities, and important moments. And I may even tell a few stories behind the interviews and share a couple of origin tales. I'm also so very proud of what we've accomplished these 25 years. You know, the world over has now been on longer than Judge Judy and Oprah. And when I think of the guests we've had, the people that I've been honored to spend time with and bring into your homes, it's been incredible. I admit, it was humble at the start, and I looked slightly younger back in 1996, only slightly. But from the earliest days, long before we moved the show to Washington, D.C., we covered political issues important to families, religious liberty, from Congress to the Supreme Court to the White House. We didn't miss much. Congressmen, speakers of the House, and congressional leaders have long been a part of the program. Even presidents have all appeared on the show to share their agenda and answer the questions that concerned you most. In 2008, shortly after we moved the show to D.C., we sat with President George W. Bush. Now, this conversation made international headlines, particularly when I asked him whether he planned to boycott the Beijing Olympics due to China's horrendous human rights record.
You just said earlier, freedom is a gift from the Almighty.
Yeah.
Considering the human rights record of that regime, how can you in good conscience go to that ceremony, Mr. President?
Because I'm going to the Olympics for starters. And I have, and my plans hadn't changed. And the reason why is because I can talk to them about religious freedom prior to the Olympics, during the Olympics, and after the Olympics, and which I have done. I don't need the Olympics to express my position to the Chinese leadership on freedom. I just don't need them, because that's all I have been doing as your president. In other words, you know, for people say, well, you need to express yourself clearly about freedom of religion. My answer is, what do you think I've been doing?
And Angela Merkel boycotted it.
I don't think she boycotted it necessarily.
Well, she's not attending the opening ceremonies, it appears.
She's not attending the games, period. She's not going to, I don't think she's going to Beijing at all. That's at least what she told me. But, you know, look, I hear all this rhetoric. I want to be an effective president. And I don't think, as I say, I'm going to Beijing. And we're talking about the Chinese people as well. And the question is the American president take decisions that'll enable the next president to be effective or not? Because I've made my case. These Chinese leaders know exactly my position. I've talked about freedom of religion every time I visited with them. I've talked about Darfur. I've talked about Burma. I've talked about the Dalai Lama. As a matter of fact, I'm the only president to ever stand up in public with the Dalai Lama here in the United States. So they know my position. And my question that I think about is, if I politicize the Olympic Games, will that make it less effective for me to deal with them or more effective? Mm-hmm. But nobody needs to tell old George Bush that he needs to bring religious freedom to the doorstep of the Chinese.
Mr. President, final question.
Yes, sir.
You said famously, when you looked into Vladimir Putin's eyes, you saw his soul.
Yeah.
When you look into Benedict XVI's eyes, what do you see?
God.
Good way to end the interview.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. My pleasure.
Then in 2016, we spoke to President Donald Trump shortly before his election.
You're a Presbyterian, so I don't want to drag you into other realms. Do you have a favorite saint?
Well, I think that if you look, Mother Teresa, who's probably our newest, is great. And Pope John Paul, I thought was terrific.
Why?
Because it had something special. It had a special something. There was a warmth. Mm-hmm. There was a toughness, but there was a warmth that was incredible. So I certainly think Pope John Paul.
Later, we joined him at the White House.
I need to get to something I've been hearing a lot of in evangelical and Catholic circles. Right. They're saying Joe Biden says he's opposed to the death penalty. And in these Catholic and evangelical circles, they say he supports efforts to end climate change. Therefore, he's pro-life and you're not. What would your response be?
So first of all, Joe Biden, I am totally in favor of the death penalty for heinous crimes, okay? That's the way it is, all right? I'm pro-life, he's not, and the Democrats, look who he's putting on the court. They want to put people on the court. You have no chance. Mm-hmm. So I'm pro-life, the Democrats aren't. Nobody can say that Biden isn't. Look at his stance over the years. But you know, and I know, Biden's not going to be running things. It's going to be run by other people. Mm-hmm. Biden's shot. It's one of those things, I hate to say it, but Biden is shot. But the Democrats are not, it's not just him, it's a party, it's a platform. Take a look at the platform. Look at the governor of Virginia. Look at what he did. He did an execution after, you know, normally they talk about late term. His wasn't late term. His was the baby was born, and then you can execute the baby. That's the Democrats, and that's Biden.
In one of my favorite interviews, I sat down with Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas. Justice Thomas spoke movingly of his grandfather who raised him and the difficult path to the highest court in the land.
Justice Thomas, I want to begin with the rough upbringing that you portray in the book and share with people in the book. What was it, 1955? Your mother puts your belongings and your brother Meyer's belongings in two grocery bags and brings you down to East 32nd Street to a White House, to your grandfather's house. You walk in and you think what?
Well, actually, you think this is a much better life. I mean, you got to remember that that house to us looked like a mansion. It's a small house when you see it, very modest, but it was very neat. They didn't have any kids, so it was very clean.
Pristine.
Oh, yes, and you weren't supposed to touch a lot of things. But the other part of it was that he always wanted to show the connection between having that and the effort it took to have that, and the kind of life you had to live to have something like that house, and to have the life that they had. And so that effort included work. It included the discipline of not spending what you didn't have. It included, again, he was a very religious man. Mm-hmm. My grandmother was religious. He was Catholic. She was Baptist. So that was all a part of the life. And it was the connection between the way you lived and what you had. And he was bound and determined, as he would say, to show us that connection.
When the vote finally happens after this brutal hearing and rehearing and coming back and testifying again and the charges, you tell your wife, when the final vote is coming down in the Senate, I'm going to take a bath. Mm-hmm. You're in the bathtub when the final vote comes. Mm-hmm. She runs in and tells you, you've been confirmed. Mm-hmm. You say what?
Whoop-de-damn-doo. That's what I said.
Did it sap the joy of the triumph?
I never had any joy. I was never really interested. Oh, no. I don't suggest that in the book. This was never any goal of mine. The President of the United States asks you to do something. Mm-hmm. What are you supposed to say? Yes, Mr. Mm-hmm. President. But my point to you is simply this, that there was no victory. I wasn't winning. This was not a contest. Mm-hmm. This wasn't about being on the court. That was not of great interest to me. Mm-hmm. But what was of interest to me is not to give in to bad people who were attacking. Now, they would like to say, well, we were just disagreeing. When you try to destroy someone, that is not about disagreeing. Hmm. That is about destroying a person. Yeah. You and I can disagree, and we can debate each other. But if I were to pick up a club and start beating you, that is not about a disagreement.
No, you're bigger than me, so
I'm trying to harm you.
You'd kill me.
It's different, yeah.
We have welcomed people from across the political spectrum and found common ground, like our pals Mary Madeline and her husband, James Carville.
You're actually much more of a traditionalist. As I read this, I thought, here's a guy he's willing to change his life to preserve his culture. He's somebody who understands the beauty of that culture and family.
Well, most people describe themselves as fiscal conservatives and socially liberal. I describe myself as economically liberal and socially traditionalist. Now, mm-hmm. I do have, there's some issues that I would not be considered so traditional on. Mm-hmm. But I do, and I've written a book about this, I think that the preferable way for a child to grow up is with two parents. And I know it's not always mm-hmm. possible, but I think that the preferable way. Mm-hmm. If people say, what's the advice for a successful life? Get married, stay married, go to school, stay in school. Mm-hmm. Okay, now, that doesn't mean that we need to look down or anything else of non-traditional families, which is certainly the way. But I would prefer, all things being equal, I would prefer that my children would grow up like that. But mm-hmm. that's just my own personal view, if mm-hmm. you will. And I got married once. I've been married once in my life. I got married when I was 49. So I tell people,
waiting for the right one.
That's it.
and Mary, anywhere. You come away as I read this. You come away, your appreciation of nature. Your love of animals, all these things, these are not traditionally, Cheney conservatism.
Yes,
it doesn't quite
Cheney
reek of that.
Cheney is a conservatism, but I do think I'm an ideologue, and I do think my Catholicism explained it to him and gave me language for it. It's subsidiarity, it's solidarity. It's mm-hmm. So these philosophies all merge. But for the record, Dick okay. Cheney is a conservationist.
Okay.
Conservation is a virtue. It's just not an energy
You
plan.
Don't work for him anymore, Madeline. It's okay.
I love the
You're
man.
Not on retainer anymore.
Man.
But all throughout these 25 years, we have not failed to hold the powerful to account. That means at times reporting on corruption and even asking tough questions. Prior to President George W. Bush's invasion of Iraq, we interviewed a Chaldean bishop who warned of the consequences of that action.
Do you think this is a justified war or a just war?
No, it is not just war at all, mm-hmm. because this war is against the people of Iraq, mm-hmm. no matter what we say. In the war, the innocent people will die.
Even if the military targets are the missile silos and
Even
Saddam Hussein's palaces.
Even if the military
palaces.
Target, they are, the many civilians will be killed.
Why do you think the Pope is so directly involved, Your Excellency?
The Pope is conscient that this war will be seen as a war between Christianity and Muslim. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And this is very bad for the world.
Not everyone was happy with that interview, but it turned out to be prescient. Look, our goal here is not to play to a political party, but to reveal the truth. When President Obama was trying to pass his health care bill in 2010, he found an ally in Sister Carol Keehan, the then president of the Catholic Health Association. Now, she defied the bishops of the U.S. who opposed Obamacare due to moral concerns. So we invited Sister Carol here on the program.
Where do you think this government plan will lead us? Go on the record.
I'll go on the record. If the plan is passed and signed into law, consistent with the principles of CHA, it will become very helpful for the dignity and the care of the poor, the unborn, and those who have insurance. And when you talk
about the plan before you, I would imagine, you tell me, the plan before us is not in any way consistent with CHA, I would imagine, yes?
There are pieces of it that are very consistent and pieces that aren't yet.
So the life issues then are secondary to this overarching goal for universal care?
Raymond, you continue to try to distort that.
No. Yeah, I want you to go on the record because people
secondary.
Are very unclear on that
secondary. I have said
system.
Clearly, and CHA has been on record clearly, we will sacrifice our preferences, not our principles. So, and we were way out there in front of anybody else talking about health reform.
I read them.
And talking about the principles. And believe me, they've gone to everybody on Capitol Hill long before anybody else was talking about
this.
But
are you willing to withdraw your support? Are you willing to threaten to withdraw your support unless these abortion language is removed, and the elders, the protection of the elderly is included in this bill, the freedom for these people.
We've already said clearly, unless our principles are met, we're not going to be supportive. We've said that clearly.
People haven't heard it, sister. Well, it's not on your website anywhere.
Because it's been distorted. When you come back and say you want health reform so much that you'll sacrifice anything, I'm not surprised that people who watch this show think that.
But it wasn't all controversy. Over the years, I feel blessed to have met many of my heroes, entertainers I grew up watching and admiring. Having the chance to talk to them, not only about their art, but about the things that matter most, remains an honor. Early in the show's history, we sat down with the great Carol O'Connor in what turned out to be his last broadcast interview. Naturally, we discussed the inspiration for his Archie Bunker, which made All in the Family a beloved touchstone for generations.
I never knew Archie growing up. I grew up in a well-to-do family. A Catholic family, by the way, and Archie, as you may remember, was anti-Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
There were Archies all around me in the community. Most of the working people I knew were Archie Bunkers. And how did I prepare for that? Well, I was a good mimic, always a good mimic. My mother was a very good mimic. She could do all these New York types of, she could do the working girls, you know. My mother used to have us in stitches, she'd do a girl. If my father knew that I was going out with that guy, he would die. So we'd hear all this and we'd hear the guys do. So I was able to do Archie, you know, the voice there. And I took a lot of that voice from Jackie Gleason, mm-hmm. Lord have mercy on him, who was a kind of a pal of mine. I didn't know him too well. I took some from Jimmy Cagney, who was a pal of mine.
Oh, really?
And I took kind of a walk I took from Wallace Beery.
Okay.
So I put together elements of these wonderful actors. I stole shamelessly from them, and you cannot lampoon the character you're playing. You cannot laugh at the character you're playing. You cannot be aware that he's funny as an actor. You have to play him intensely, and you have to play him fiercely and angrily, and that's what makes him funny.
Amen. Will you look at me standing here? Will you look at that poor face on me here? How many times did I beg your hands and knees never use my razor?
If you could write for me the final line of the Carol O'Connor story, what would that line be?
Think of me kindly, friends. I didn't mean it.
God love you.
And it didn't stop there. The actor Ricardo Montalban also sat with me for a touching interview. He was in excruciating pain when we met, but you'd never know that from his grace and bearing.
You said, this was just not very long ago, the single most difficult job of your career was playing Mr. Rourke. Why did you say that?
But the thing that was difficult about it was that if you ask any actor what is the most difficult thing to do is exposition, where you set the stage for somebody else. In Fantasy Island, I couldn't become involved emotionally. I couldn't express any kind of strong emotions because I was the perfect host. Mm-hmm. Welcome to Fantasy Island.
Smiles, everyone, smiles, I remember. Everyone.
And I was the perfect host and in control. Never in doubt that I could solve any control. Therefore, who is that boss? Well, that's me, so-and-so. What's her fantasy, boss? Well, her fantasy is that when she was a child, her mother took away a little doll, and then the little doll has become a symbol of the love of her mother, and the mother is dead, and she would like to be able to get the little doll again. You see, now, that is very uninteresting to say. You can't, you know, you've got
fascinating
to,
for the audience, difficult as an actor.
Well, because you have to, the audience can go, unless you imbue it with interest, vitality, mm-hmm. a little inventiveness. Ah, her mother said that. You know, mm-hmm. I never was involved in things of love or passion or anything. Mm-hmm. You see, it was very mm-hmm. difficult to do. For 7 years I did that. That's very tough.
My final question.
Yes.
How do you want to be remembered?
God, that's difficult.
That's why I asked it.
I would like to be remembered simply as a man who, having had many weaknesses, tried to conquer them. He never gave up trying to conquer them. He never conquered them all, but he always tried to conquer them.
Then there were a few Academy Award winners who resonated deeply with all of you and me as well. The first is Academy Award winning director and actor Mel Gibson. We scored the first exclusive interview before the release of the 2004 blockbuster, The Passion of the Christ. We were on the set in Rome with he and actor Jim Caviezel. Then I spoke with Gibson at the height of the controversy over his film just before release. There were no ground rules and no question was off limit. The result was classic Mel Gibson.
Are you anti-Semitic?
Of course not. And if I was, I wouldn't have been working in this town with the people I've worked with for so many years, nor would they have wanted to work with me. I mean, it's ludicrous. It's ludicrous to think this. I don't want to lynch any Jews. I mean, it's not what I'm about. I love them. I pray for them. I pray sincerely that every man, woman, and child of the Jewish people ends up with his name written in the book of life.
What do you make of their charge? But then they say, this movie could serve as a toxic recipe for religious hatred, could legitimize anti-Semitism. Will it?
No. This is rubbish. This is absolute rubbish. This film is about faith, hope, love, and forgiveness. That's what it's about.
Does this film attempt to collectively blame the death of Jesus on the Jewish people?
This film collectively blames humanity on the death of Jesus. Now, there are no exemptions there. All right? I'm first on the line for culpability. I did it. Christ died for all men, for all times.
Including Jewish people.
Yeah. They're part of the human race, you know, and it's humanity that's culpable. I'm first on the line. I did it, okay?
Then there was a comic genius that I was thrilled to know. He was a groundbreaking filmmaker and an international cultural icon whose career spanned more than 80 years. He remains one of my favorite interviews. There are times when you just connect with someone. That was the case when I met Jerry Lewis.
You're in Atlantic City, you're at the 500 Club, and you call a singer that you only met once or twice, Italian singer, Dean Martin. What made that act work from that first night, and how choreographed was it? How much planning did you all do before you went out the first time?
None. No planning. We both went out on stage and looked to save our lives, because if we didn't do a show at midnight that night, we'd have been wearing cement shoes. I'm quoting Skinny D'Amato.
Oh, boy.
And we did, Dean as a single performer would do four songs, it's 12 minutes. Mm-hmm. I did an act that ran 13 minutes because I did a dumb act to recordings.
Pantomime.
Between Dean and I, we didn't even do a half hour. So the boys came backstage after the show and said, Jerry, you said that you two would do some funny things together. That's why we brought him in. When are you going to do that? I said, we never do it the first show. We plan everything after the first show. And I'm writing on a piece of rye bread paper that the sandwiches came in. And I'm writing a rundown of ideas that I took from my dad, from burlesque, from every show I ever saw. And we did 2 hours and 20 minutes. Mm. Not knowing what we were doing. The minds locked together unlike anything I'd ever seen in my life. Huh. My mind locked into his locked into mine, and we worked that first night no differently than we did the 10th year.
You gotta drink milk.
I don't want no milk. Rocky, you see that he takes his milk.
I'm with you.
Yeah. Get out. Wait in the car.
All right, you're gonna get your milk.
No, Rocky, not that, Rocky.
Yeah.
All right, Rock, give me a break, Rocky.
No, you're gonna get it.
Oh, Rocky, give me a break, Rocky.
No,
Rocky, give me a break, Rocky.
Drink your milk.
No, I don't.
Drink it. It's good for you. Milk is good for you.
I don't want it.
As I close out, I'm gonna tell a little secret on my producer here, Chris. When he walked into the room, he just said hello to you, and he came out. And he said, look, I've got tears in my eyes. I said, what's wrong? He said, when I walked in, I don't know. It was just being in front of Jerry Lewis. But you know what? It's just what you're talking about. He's responding to all the memories of the laughs and the joy that you've given him and all of us all these years. And I'm delighted to have been with you for a little bit.
I think you're about the best interviewer I've ever had.
Oh, come on. Now you're going to make me blush.
I've had a few, starting back with Tynan in London.
Oh, wow. Kenneth Tynan.
And Robert Benayoun in Paris. And Olof Newton in Sweden. I've had some heavy-duty people.
I'll say.
You're the best interviewer, and I've had thousands of them in my life, and you're the best. Well, you are articulate. You know what you're going to talk about. You're interested in the answer. That's the key. Yeah. You're interested in everything you ask me to see what the answer is. And that draws from me eager to do more for you.
Well, you are awesome. And it's an honor.
Thank you.
It's been one of the highlights of my career. I loved me some Jerry. Then there was a Broadway legend whom I had been warned about before I did this interview. But I figured, look, I'd sat opposite reportedly difficult people in the past who turned out to be incredible interviews. Elaine Stritch was by far the most difficult interview I have ever conducted. She was battling diabetes, took an insulin shot as I walked in and a shot of something else in a glass. Elaine insisted that I interview her right before her nightclub act in New York. God rest her soul, this is an example of having no connection at all.
Let's turn the mics on, or you won't get anything worthwhile.
I've seen you, I have to say, since I was about that big all these years. I just saw you the other night here at the Cafe Carlyle. Did you imagine?
Did you ever hear any of the jokes about Betty Davis? I've loved you ever since. Wait a minute. I haven't asked you the question yet. When Betty Davis said, when somebody comes up to her and says, I've loved you ever since I've... You should know better than that. You're hip enough to know better than that. Elaine, I have seen you ever since I was... Boy, are you looking for a...
I'm sorry. I'm guilty as charged.
Unbelievable. I mean, you are the proof positive of what all those jokes are based on.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Yes, right back at you.
I deserved it.
Thanks a lot.
You're absolutely right. You work with the great Noel Coward, who you were cast in his plays when you were, 18 years old? You were in one of his plays?
Well, he came to see me in my first big musical in Philadelphia because he'd heard that I was good from...
Goldilocks.
The conductor, the great conductor. What's his name? The famous, famous conductor. West Side Story. Bernstein.
Leonard Bernstein.
Who said that?
Chris.
What do you do for a living?
He's my producer.
Yeah, well, you're his producer. Oh, good. I'm glad it isn't the other way around. You're where you belong.
Thank you, Elaine.
That's all right.
We need help. That's why. He needs my help.
Good.
Stritch finally kicked the drinking habit following a diabetic attack that nearly took her life in 1988. But when I tried to get her to explain how she wrestled the alcoholism into submission, she would have none of it.
I don't want to talk about drinking. Yeah. Drinking was a problem because I liked it too much.
But you overcame it.
So I quit it.
You overcame it.
Well, that's all right, but I don't want to talk about that either.
Because I think it's a fascinating part of your story, how you overcame
the drink. Well, maybe so. Someday we'll do an interview about booze. I'm not going to do it now, this close to the show.
Okay.
It's too complicated, and it's too in detail.
How do you want to be remembered? As a performer? As an individual?
As somebody who cares enough about her career and entertaining an audience so that she can level with her interviewer before the show that she's got to go. That's how I want to be remembered.
That's how you'll
tell
be
the
remembered.
Truth. How about that?
Thank you, dear.
All right. It was nice meeting you. Nice talking to you. And now let go of me.
You're gone.
All right.
Now she is gone, but not forgotten. I loved her on stage. On stage. That catastrophe is a good segue to some seismic events that we've covered over the years. I've had a front row seat to history in this chair. I accompanied you through the heartache and hope of 9/11.
As I saw it and I looked at it, I said, gee, you know, I know he's here. Godzilla must be here somewhere because it looked like pieces of buildings were knocked over, just like, you'd see in the movies.
We were there in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, which my fellow New Orleanians and I experienced personally. We also look for hope, even amid chaos on the world over. I've interviewed hundreds of church leaders, laymen, cardinals, bishops, brilliant theologians, and the greatest preachers of the day. Each brought special insight and perspective to the program just when we needed it. But not long before his election, I interviewed Benedict XVI, Joseph Ratzinger. It would become his only English language interview. I asked His Eminence about his long-held wish to retire and his vision of the new springtime of the church.
Talk for a moment about the new springtime. The Pope has talked a great deal about the new springtime, and you yourself have laid out your own ideas. Your vision is a little different from some. Some see the numbers growing and everybody believing and dancing hand in hand into the millennium. You see a different picture. Tell us what that picture involves. How do you see this springtime evolving?
Yes, I do not exclude even this dancing hand in hand, but this is only one moment. And my idea is that really the springtime of the church will not say that we will have in a near time masses of conversions, that all people of the world will be converted to Catholicism. This is not the way of God. But we will have really convinced communities with elan mm-hmm. of the faith. No? And this is springtime. If new life in very convinced persons with joy of the faith.
But smaller numbers.
Smaller numbers, I think. But from these small numbers, we will have a radiation of joy in the world and so also an attraction. As it was in the old church, even when Constantine make public religion Christians, there are a small percentage of this time, but mm-hmm. it was clear this is the future. So we can live in the future. This gives us the way in a different future. Mm-hmm. And so I would say, if we have young people really with the joy of the faith and with the radiation of this joy of the faith, this will show to the world, even if I cannot share it, even if I cannot convert it in this moment, here is the way to life for tomorrow. Mm.
You've been here for 21 years in this post, and I've read in many reports you wanted to retire several times. Why are you still here?
Yes, I had the desire to retire in 91, 96, 2001, because I have the idea I could write some books and return to my studies as Cardinal Martini did.
Right.
So it was my idea to do the same thing. But from the other hand, seeing the suffering Pope, I cannot say to the Pope, I will retire, I will write my books. Seeing him, how he's getting himself, I have to continue.
Then there was the conclave that temporarily blocked Ratzinger's retirement. In April of 2005, following the death of John Paul the Great, the world's cardinals gathered in Rome to elect a new pontiff. What a joy it was to take you all on that week's long journey with my dear friend, Father Richard John Newhouse.
Bell sounds at St. Peter's. How is one to distinguish between the bells of confirmation and the bells tolling the 15 minutes have passed? So we wait.
If our Lord had entrusted the church to angels, we wouldn't have this trouble. But there are bells. That is not the 6 o'clock bell.
No.
That's
from a local church over here.
Well, the word was that as soon as the word went out from the Holy See, all the churches of Rome would start ringing their bells.
Right.
Are we going to hear that?
But the question I had when I heard that initially is how.
Who's going to let them
how
know?
How are all these little How's pastors that? Spread throughout Rome to know when the world's media spending millions and with jumping on top of Navarro balls at this hour?
Raymond, at the risk of interrupting our chatter, it seems to me now that we have to say Habemus Papam. We have a pope. The smoke is white.
No, there's no one is confirming this yet, and we will not either, Father. You can say that.
Well,
but I won't.
Okay, no, I'm
we have confirmation. It appears we do have a new pope.
It appears.
Habemus Papam.
Habemus Papam, as best we can tell.
Habemus Papam.
My God.
Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger is the 265th Pope, the 264th successor to St. Peter.
And after the stunning retirement of Pope Benedict in early 2013, we were back in Rome to cover another conclave. By that point, Father Richard had died, so I had to assemble a new team to cover this new conclave. Father Gerald Murray, Robert Royal, and Father Roger Landry heeded the call, and the papal posse was born.
We'll see whether the smoke is black or white this evening. I'm joined once again by my entire conclave crew, and we came up with that name first, boys. Welcome to this final day of Pope Francis's meeting with families in Philadelphia. I'm Raymond Arroyo, delighted to be joined once again by the papal posse, Robert Royal, Father Gerald Murray. We saw him meet the bishops of Cuba. What do you expect to see? He also met his bishops in Washington. So I don't know quite what we're going to see here.
Well, I'm sure it'll be an encouragement further to the American bishops as regards the family, because that's the subject, of course, of this weekend meeting.
What do you make of this image of this fertility god, and what's the message here?
The ceremony was accurately described as a pagan religious ceremony, and that statue is the goddess, false goddess, Pachamama, who is like a creation god. This is horrendous, I have to say.
Of course, it's already scandalous that this sort of pagan worship has entered into the Vatican itself.
And the papal posse is still riding. In the age of Pope Francis, the Synod on the Family became a battle royale among the cardinals. Cardinals Raymond Burke and Walter Casper represented the two sides of a debate over whether divorced and civilly remarried Catholics could receive the sacraments. We had them both on our air.
How do you preserve the indissolubility of marriage, that ideal, when you have what is essentially a fast track back to the sacraments for people in irregular unions of whatever sort?
Well, first of all, indissolubility of marriage for me is faith of the Church. And because it's the word of Jesus Christ, you cannot create exceptions.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a question how to apply the word of Jesus to concrete situations.
Uh-huh.
It's a question of And I thought the church has the authority to bind and to loose, and the church can, in certain cases, make use of this authority.
Does Amoris Laetitia and the Pope himself permit divorced and remarried Catholics now in irregular relationships who are sexually active to receive communion?
The problem is that to engage in sexual union with someone who's not your spouse is a grave sin, and to live in such a state publicly means that one cannot have access to the sacraments because he or she is not living according to the truth of Christ. And there's no way that the church can give permission for someone to do something which Christ himself does not give us permission to do.
We've also interviewed some incredible journalists over the years. One of them was the dean of the Washington Political Press Corps and one of my mentors. When he was ready to talk about converting to Catholicism, I was honored that the so-called Prince of Darkness, that was his moniker around here, he reached out to me. This is the consummate shoe leather reporter, Robert Novak.
In Syracuse University, I was giving a speech there, and the sponsoring group, the college Republicans, as they do before a lecture, they have the committee has a little dinner for you before, and there were all men and one young woman, and I noticed that she wore around her neck a crucifix, and I said, "Are you a Catholic?" And I don't know why I asked her that. It's, you know, I usually don't ask things like that, and I thought she said yes. As it turns out, I've later found she said no. She was Greek Orthodox, and but I thought she said yes, and then she said, "Are you a Catholic?" I said, "No, I said that my wife and I have been going to Mass for many years." And she said, "Are you going to convert?" I said, "No, we have no such plans." And she said, "Mr. Novak, life is short, but eternity is forever." And I got a chill up my back. I got a chill right now when I said it. I always get a chill when I think of that. And it was like the Holy Spirit was there. I could hardly sleep that night. And I came back to Washington the next morning, and I told Geraldine, "I think I'm ready to be a Catholic." And I think she was ready, had been ready for a long time.
Then there was this memorable conversation in Stamford, Connecticut, at the home of this next columnist, novelist and founder of National Review, William F. Buckley, Jr.
Excuse the mess, but I can't pretend it's the only day I was ever messing.
Is this where you write your articles when you're here? And
yeah.
Your books?
So I do all my work here. This was a four-car garage.
Oh.
So the first few years I did one, then another one. Inevitably that happened.
When you write, I'm told you play Bach.
A little bit, yeah.
Why?
Well, why not?
I want to talk for a moment about the intersection between your politics and your faith. Russell Kirk said your politics are more a function of your faith than your economics. How true is that?
The Bible absolutely insists on individual sovereignty in conscience and makes the case for freedom. God created us to be free. Under the circumstances, if you want complementary positive law, it should be a law that encourages that freedom. In my judgment, that which does so most successfully and which permits the development and the distribution of scarce resources is conservative political ideals of the kind that I have backed. That is the sense in which the two are connected, the insistence on the individuality of the human being. If we are, in fact, in God's eyes, all different, then any society that seems to say that we are not different has got to be wrong.
Many years ago, I interviewed the columnist and former presidential speechwriter, Patrick Buchanan. Pat wrote bestsellers like Suicide of a Superpower, Where the Right Went Wrong, The Death of the West. At the time, every title sounded bleaker than the last. In hindsight, it looked like coming attractions.
Explain
the great betrayal? What is the great betrayal, and who's being betrayed?
I think the people first and foremost that are being betrayed are American workers and American families who used to have the highest standard of living in the world that rose every year. And now it takes both the husband and wife to go out into the labor market to earn enough to maintain the family standard of living. And one of the reasons is, under this regime of the global economy, America is exporting its plants, its factories, the manufacturing jobs, the highest paying jobs in America for working men and working women. Secondly, the United States of America, which fought its revolution for economic as well as political independence, is sacrificing that to this global new world order. To me, it is basically a utopian ideology, this globalism, and it's determinedly anti-Christian.
The fact is, as you read the book, you do see and you point out stark statistics that undergird your argument,
right,
that we really are in a very serious moment in American history.
And why I say it to your reversible and the religious argument. You know, religion is the fundamental basis of ethics and morality, and we've had a moral consensus in this country. We did, mm-hmm, all the way from the Revolution all the way up to the 1960s.
But why is it important to people who may not be religious at all, Pat?
Because when the religion dies, the moral consensus dies, the moral code is thrown over, the ethics die, you got the privatization of morality, mm-hmm, everybody does what he wants, and I think that leads to cultural and social suicide for a nation. Mm-hmm. The problems here are not going to be solved by a Pat Buchanan or even a Ronald Reagan. I think we need a St. Paul, quite frankly. Mm-hmm. Or you need a great awakening again in this country and awareness of where we're going. And it better come pretty soon, mm-hmm, because I think the country's going downhill. And when the common faith and ethics and morality go, the society disintegrates, it breaks down, mm-hmm, and everybody is at war with everybody. It's almost the war of all against all.
As longtime viewers of the show know, music is a passion of mine. And I love that we've been able to bring some of the greatest global superstars, classics all, to the world over. To spend time with each and every one of them was an honor, and to sing with them was heaven.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas.
Voices like this don't come out of 74-year-old bodies. I've got to tell you that.
They do if God's leading them. And I don't mean to sound overly religious because, uh-huh, you know, I just feel that he's with me all the time.
Okay.
But I truly believe it is a God-given thing because I didn't have to work at it. I've been very blessed with it. And like I said, I don't abuse it.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. It's a happiest season of all.
Before I let you go, can you fulfill a huge Christmas wish of mine?
Now, what would that be?
Could we sing I Wish You a Merry Christmas?
You want to sing I Wish You a Merry Christmas?
You and me,
all
together.
Right. We wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Harmony with the great man himself. Thank you.
Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you.
You went from The Wanderer, which I am going to ask you to do a little bit of because it so captures. Do you see that as kind of capturing your kind of tough guy street approach to life early on? Or is that a misnomer to try to assign that song to you? Personal.
Well, first of all, let me explain the song.
Mm-hmm.
I roam from town to town. I go through life without a care. I'm as happy as a clown with my two fists of iron, but I'm going nowhere. So the song turns back on itself, and it's really saying, you know, yeah, I'm this and I'm that.
Happy as a clown, not a happy character.
It's a song that's showing that, you know, it's has a little awareness to it where the guy just sees for a second, he goes, I'm not going anywhere.
Yeah, yeah, there's a little truth, bitter truth in it. Right.
So a lot of people think it's about a lot of fun, you know, and, and I understand that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah.
I'm the type of guy that likes to roam around. I'm never in one place. I roam from town to town. Find myself falling for some girl. A hot kitty that caught my driver.
How have you managed to keep this voice? I mean, I just heard you not too long ago. To keep this voice in such amazing condition at 68 years old with this tireless schedule, what do you do? What is the technique?
Well, I think I'm lucky to be healthy, first of all, to really work my technique, to, across the years, across the time, to decide which repertoire I will sing, which in which part of my life, mm-hmm. and I think it's the great passion that I have for this. Of course, vocally, the voice is a very delicate instrument, mm-hmm. and you live with it, you know. So everything affects you. If you have bad news, you know. If you eat wrong, something wrong. Mm-hmm. If you have a frustration, anything mm-hmm. reflects in the voice. So you have to separate things. You have to be able to dominate those feelings.
But I'm told by friends, mutual friends, you're not precious about it, though. You don't wrap the voice. You don't stop speaking all day when you have a performance. I mean, you are using the instrument all day, yes?
Well, I try to. If I can be quiet the day before a performance, mm-hmm. yes, you know.
There's something I've observed. I've watched you as an audience member on television, but certainly live. You move your jaw in a certain way. And I always thought, I mean, you really work, your jaw moves in unpredictable ways when you're singing. I used to think that was to accommodate the tone and the beautiful sounds you were making to sort of move that tone into this place to resonate.
You know what it was?
It's not.
No. When I was a child, as most poor children are, they go to the dentist, and if you have a cavity in your tooth, mm-hmm. they pull it.
Yeah.
In those days. So I had several cavities on one side of my mouth, and they took all my teeth out. And so it made my mouth lopjaw. So in order for me to open my mouth, I had to do like that.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it was quite traumatic for me to watch myself in the early days. Dentistry caught up mm-hmm. to the world. Hmm. I was told that there was some help for me. Hmm. And I found a wonderful dentist who straightened things out for me.
Isn't it interesting, though, that this, something you wouldn't ask for, you know, something a child didn't desire, it ended up shaping your tone and making your sound.
Yes, yes.
And it's what we remember. It's what you produce even now, mm-hmm. is that same sound. I mean, that's got to be a curious thing for you.
Yeah, all sorts of wonderful things happen out of an unfortunate situation.
Right.
Yeah. For instance, how many people of great, you know, importance in the world have come from humble beginnings. And it makes us all quite humble.
Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Oye, Ramón. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad, prospero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas.
bottom of my heart.
What makes a great song for Harry Connick?
That's a great question. For me, there's three basic components to it. There are the lyrics, there's the melody, and then there are the harmonies or the chords that go with them. The lyrics and the melody are the most important things. And I think writing a melody that's singable and something that you can remember is a good quality. Having lyrics that can touch you emotionally or maybe make you laugh or cry.
To fear and grace, my fears relieve. How precious in that grace appear. Our 25 years
and we're just getting started. I am so grateful to every one of the people you saw tonight for the experience of knowing them. Throughout the years, I've tried to stay close to Mother Angelica's example of truth mingled with humor and good cheer. And close to you, our EWTN World Over family. We do this show for you, and I've now been doing it for half my life. I am so thankful to you for standing by us, for being here week after week. You know, when you honestly report controversies, you're bound to upset somebody. People you never imagined are suddenly talking about the show. They badmouth you, they try to undermine you, but look, my approach is simple. Keep doing the work and keep telling the truth. 25 years later, we're still standing, and that's all due to you and a very important group of people. My World Over team, Chris Edwards, my executive producer, who's been with me for 20 years, could not do this show without him. Christina Kelly, Elena Isela, who helped shape each of the segments we bring you each week. Jonathan Watley, who edits every episode, and our entire crew. You all do so much week in and week out to make this show happen. Thank you all. And happy anniversary to the world over, to our crew in D.C., to our extended family around the world. As a gift to celebrate this silver anniversary, we are going to be sharing unseen interviews and segments over the next few months, things that I had frankly forgotten about, hadn't seen in years, but I think you're going to love them. So stay tuned for that. I believe storytelling is important and changes the world, whether it's fiction or nonfiction, or the reports we file every week. It has a major influence on not only the present, but the future. Until next week, I will continue to scout the world over for all that is seen and unseen. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thank you for making this so special. I love you. I'm Raymond Arroyo. See you next time. Bye now.